So, Elizabeth Barrett Browning's poem, Sonnet 43. If you've clicked on this video, you want to get some analysis for it, which is excellent and you've come to the right place. However, as you can see there, I've already analysed half of the poem. This is part two of my analysis. So, watch that bit first and then come back and watch this bit. And without any further ado, here's part two. Oh God, I rhymed. So this is where part one of my Sonnet 43 analysis finished. We had four questions for the poem's final six lines, and I hope you had time to look at those, think about them, and maybe make your own annotations. But now back to Liam in the video, and he's going to go through some possible answers to those questions. There's a few different autobiographical references in these lines. Old griefs could suggest the emotions she felt when her mother or brothers died. She suggests that she will feel love for Robert of a similar intensity as she felt grief for their deaths, as seen in I Love Thee with the Passion Put to Use. Childhood faith links to her devout childhood religiosity. Remember, in her own words, Barrett Browning was a religious enthusiast, suggesting that she is enthusiastic in her love for Robert. My Lost Saints could recall the fact that Barrett Browning felt her faith lessen as she grew older. Robert has replaced these saints, as she is now loving him with the love she thought had vanished when she lessened her faith. Altogether, these autobiographical references suggest that she believes that Robert will play a key part in her life. Loving him is as important to her as grieving her dead family members, as strong as her belief in God was as a child, and so significant that it has filled the void left behind by her wavering faith. As with the earlier use of juxtaposition, Barrett Browning contrasts opposites to show that her love for Robert is enduring. She will love him in the good times and the bad times. This also recalls traditional wedding vows, for better or for worse. Caesurae is just the plural of caesura, and a caesura is a pause or stop in the middle of a line of poetry. Using caesurae breaks up the rhythm or flow of the poem. Now, this breakup of the rhythm could be symbolic of Barrett Browning's excitement and passion. Her feelings are so intense that they cannot be contained or constrained by formal poetic features. She feels so passionate that she cannot stay focused on one idea for particularly long. As it says on screen now, the final line of the poem looks towards death. Barrett Browning subverts traditional wedding vows by expressing that her love for Robert will remain after she has died. It's important to note, however, that she is looking for God's approval of this, suggesting that she believes her love for Robert is pure. Before we move on from analysing the poem, I want to consider the whole poem from two different angles. So, first, I want to think about religion. Barrett Browning has used a semantic field of religion throughout this poem, but where? How and why? What's the overall effect and meaning of doing that? So I've highlighted a few places where I think religious language is used. You might agree or disagree or have some extras, and that's okay. Soul suggests that this poem is metaphysical and is about a love that is beyond earthly. Being and ideal grace, where words are capitalised midline where they grammatically shouldn't be, Barrett Browning is using them in a religious or spiritual sense. This line in particular suggests that her love is equal to her desire to understand and be close to God. I've highlighted candlelight because candles have connotations of prayer. Maybe it suggests that Robert is her idol now. Right and praise are capitalized, which again suggests they're being used in maybe a more religious or spiritual sense. And the final three things I've highlighted are things we've just discussed. So that semantic field elevates Robert to a godlike status, which is actually somewhat blasphemous. But that also shows the intensity of Barrett Browning's feelings for Robert. It suggests that her love for him is pure and right and proper. It's almost like Barrett Browning's trying to defend her love, and maybe she's defending it against her father. Now, this semantic field of religion overall is very much representative of the 19th century, of Barrett Browning's worldly experiences, but also the people around her. See, religion being a key part of people's lives back in the 19th century. And here's the second whole poem consideration. I want us to think about how perfect of a sonnet this poem is. Now, I'm hoping that you already made notes on what sonnets are, or that you otherwise already know what sonnets are. But just in case you've forgotten or can't remember it right now, I've included the rules of a sonnet on the screen now. If you'd like to pause the video to get your own ideas down on paper first, now's a good time to do that. And again, feel free to share those ideas down in the comments section. At a glance, this is a pretty perfect sonnet. It's about love, it's 14 lines long, and the rhyme scheme and rhythm, they seem to be pretty perfect. So if you would see this sonnet as a representation of her love for Robert, you could say that her love for Robert is pretty perfect. You could also reflect her dedication to him. Writing a sonnet is difficult, and I know, I've got my master's degree in creative writing. To write such a perfect sonnet, let alone 43 others, shows an immense level of dedication on Barrett Browning's part. She must really, really love Robert. And yet, if we look a bit closer, I don't think it's 100% perfect. Grace, I'd argue, doesn't fully rhyme with ways and days. The final sounds are slightly but significantly different. Also, when I count the syllables out, the fourth and fifth lines don't have 10 syllables but 11. Maybe that's just me. I'm sure you could say a lot about what that slight imperfection could represent. An idea that comes to my mind is that Barrett Browning is not used to such a perfect love. She certainly didn't get that sort of love from her father. And so maybe she's unable to fully comprehend or express the perfection of the love that she's receiving. So now that we've analysed the poem closely, it's time to step back and consider the poem holistically. And to do that, we're going to consider the poem's meaning, mood and motivation. If you're looking at your screen right now and have no idea what I'm talking about, I suggest going back and having a quick look at my video on Simon Armitage's The Manhunt, where I explain the three M's in detail. I'll try to put something up there for you. Now, if you want to tackle this on your own, feel free to pause the video now and make notes. Otherwise, my ideas will appear on screen in a couple of moments. So there's my summary of the poem. I said that writing to her eventual husband, Robert Browning, Elizabeth Barrett Browning lists the way in which she loves him by using a sonnet. She begins in general terms in the octet for expressing herself in a more personal way, by relating her love for Robert to things from her past in the poem's sestet. As I hope you can see, I've tried to use bits of context throughout the poem, whilst also trying to cover the poem in its entirety. The mood of this poem is fairly straightforward, I think. I said that the poem is overwhelmingly loving and devotional, and I've highlighted the repetition of I love thee. Do you disagree with me, or do you think I've oversimplified the poem's mood? If so, please let me know in the comments section. And finally, there's my ideas about Browning's motivation. Again, I've used lots of context there, whilst also using three different evaluative verbs. I've said that writing this sonnet to him as she sent him a letter, Elizabeth Barrett Browning elevates Robert Browning to a godlike status, highlighting the importance he and his love have to her, especially considering the difficulties she has faced in life, including illness, the death of relatives, a controlling father, and so on. Here we've got a theme table again. I've explained this in my last video, the one for Simon Armitage's The Manhunt, in the part two for that one. In short, I think you're going to find it really useful to produce a large table for these themes with a row for each of the 18 anthology poems. So thinking about the themes, this is what I would have done. This poem can relate to the theme of power, in this case, the power of love. This poem is not about nature, but I do hope that you'd agree with me that this poem is about love. This poem is not about war, and it's not overwhelmingly about time either. I could agree with you if you ticked it, I guess. Elizabeth Barrett Browning does talk about the love or intense emotions she had as a child, and suggests that moving forwards, her love for Robert will replace that. Maybe, I just don't think there's enough to do with time in there, really. There's no real reference to place in this poem, but definitely this poem is about man. It's about a man, Robert Browning, a woman, Elizabeth Barrett Browning, and a couple, Elizabeth and Robert, and their relationship. So certainly, man, yep. Although the final sort of word in this poem is about death, this poem isn't really overwhelmingly about death. Beyond the final line of the poem, I think you'd struggle for things to say, and for that reason, I wouldn't tick death in this case. Religion, though, definitely. Religion appears throughout this poem, in both Barrett Browning's use of religious language and her references to God, but also in the way that she seems to idolise and worship Robert Browning. Disagree or think differently? Please let me know in the comments section down below. Okay, so your optional revision task for this poem is to write an essay plan about how love has been presented in it, which should be quite easy, right? Follow whichever essay structure you've been taught at school. I don't want to undermine your teachers or tell you something different that might confuse you, so do whatever you've been taught in school. If you've been taught to use an introduction or an overview, plan it. If you haven't, don't. If you've been taught to use two main paragraphs, use two. If you've been taught to use three, use three. Use whichever paragraph structure you've been taught to use. Pearl, pissoir, squid, whatever. Whatever you've been taught to use, use it. The important thing is that you start to think about which quotations or textual references you might use in order to answer the question that's on screen. That could be as simple as writing paragraph one as a subheading and writing the quotation or quotations and note form analysis for them, and then moving on to your second paragraph and so on. I'm not suggesting that you write the whole essay right now. Although if you want to or find that easier, somehow do. Really, this is about getting your ideas down on paper first. So that is our analysis of Sonnet 43 done. As ever, thank you once again for watching this video. I really, really, really do hope it's helped you in your revision. And if it has helped you, please don't forget to give this video a like, subscribe to my channel, Dystopia Junkie, and turn on that notification bell too, so that all upcoming videos, and believe me, there's a lot of them, end up straight in your subscription feed. As I've said a few times throughout this video, there's a comment section down below that I'm inviting you to use. If you want to add in your own analysis, do so. If you want to ask me a question about anything I've said in this video, do so. If you want to just tell me how amazing I am, do so. Have an awesome rest of the day. And remember, if you're revising, take frequent short breaks. A burned out student is not a happy or successful student. So at the start of part one of my Sonnet 43 analysis, I asked a question. I asked, why might someone say, I love you, or I love thee, 9 times in a 14 line poem? Well, maybe they repeat it so much because they're so overwhelmed by their feelings of love. Feelings of love that they haven't really experienced before in life. I think that's something we should really celebrate and respect. Fair play, Elizabeth. You found love in the end.